I grew up in high school playing water polo. I want to know how many of you have ever seen a water polo game played live? Okay, how many of you have ever seen a water polo game on TV? So water polo players have an affinity for the Olympic Games because that's practically the only time you could have seen it on TV when I was in high school. Now we've got all these special channels and you can dial in and maybe get those games, but the Olympics were always really important to me. This particular image on the screen is an image from the Olympic Games in Vancouver, the Winter Games of 2010. I want to talk a little bit about our light shining for all to see. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, bless us this morning as we think about your word, as we think about your promise, as we think about your power at work in our lives. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. The prophets of the scripture have a phrase that they often use as their speaking, and that phrase is, "Thus saith the Lord." When a prophet speaks, they are the mouthpiece of God. They're speaking for God, and that's why it was so important that they speak truth, that they not make things up, that they not speak on their own account, but rather that they only spoke the words that God gave them to speak. And there's a powerful notion for all of us, but especially Joe and Abby, for you today. Now, I didn't pick these texts for your confirmation, but I'm really excited about these texts for your confirmation today. Listen again to the opening verses of Isaiah chapter 62. Because I love Joe, because I love Abby, because I love my people, I will not keep still. Because my heart yearns for Jerusalem, the center of his people, I cannot remain silent. I will not stop praying for her until her righteousness shines like the dawn and her salvation blazes like a burning torch. Now, I will tell you that the origins of the torch in the Olympic Games do not root themselves in Christian theology. And in fact, they root themselves in some Greek mythology. But the idea is when a city is granted the ability to host the Olympic Games, they put some of their best designers at work to come up with a design for a new torch that is high in the air for all to see, that tell them that the Olympic Games is going on. And our light, our torch, needs to be lifted high for all to see so that people know God is at work in us and through us and in our world. God is at work here. When we ask you to let your light shine, when we ask you, Joe, to let your light shine, we're asking you to let people know that God is at work in you. But we're talking about Isaiah 62. Isaiah 62 is a prophetic word written, most likely, about the exile, where the temple and Jerusalem have been annihilated, destroyed, torn down. Listen to these words from 2 Kings chapter 25. On August 14 of that year, which was the 19th year of King Nebuchadnezzar's reign, Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard and an official of the Babylonian king, arrived in Jerusalem. He burned down the temple of the Lord, the royal palace, and all the houses of Jerusalem. He destroyed all the important buildings of the city. Then he supervised the entire Babylonian army as they tore down the walls of Jerusalem on every side. It's easy to believe promises when the likelihood of the fulfillment of the promise is obvious. But God speaks His word through the prophet Isaiah in the midst of Israel's utter despair. In the midst of the Babylonian captivity, where they've been taken away, their city has been destroyed, and they have been enslaved. So what is this promise of God intended to do for us? What is supposed to happen as a result of this word being spoken by a prophet in utter opposition to their current reality and despair? It is intended to bring hope. Hope changes everything. It allows us to give our best in the midst of circumstances that say we have no chance. It allows us to love sacrificially and deeply another, even though the chances of that person changing from all outward looks is remote. But we are called to follow the same thing the prophet is following, and that is the character of our God, who is faithful and keeps His promises. I have to imagine that there was some times of prayer for the prophets when God gave them a word and they looked up and said, "Right. Okay, now what do you really want me to say?" One of my favorite prophets is actually Jeremiah, because Jeremiah also was the writer of Lamentation. Jeremiah's people failed over and over and over again to take him seriously. They failed over and over again to heed the warnings of God, and instead felt the punishment that Jeremiah had warned them would happen. And yet, in the midst of that failure to persuade, he was faithful in continuing to say whatever it is that God called him to say. He trusted, even in the midst of despair, that God would be at work. "The Lord will hold you in His hand for all to see, a splendid crown in the hand of God." Joe, when you look in the mirror, remember who you are. A splendid crown in the hand of God, the apple of His eye. The whole bride concept works a little better for you, Abby, that was in the text. This idea that you are special to God, and don't forget it, because just as the prophet says, "I will not stop," he speaks for God, and we need to understand today, all of us, that God will not stop until He transforms your heart and your life. A part of the reason that we have as our mission statement that we are transformed as we follow Jesus daily, leading others to do the same, is that we believe in the power of God, not that we believe in our own power to transform, but we believe that God won't stop until He has His way with us. He's gonna keep coming after you. Luther called it the hound of heaven. And then I had studied the first lesson, and I had studied the second lesson, and I came to the gospel for today, and we're going to be looking at it again in Lent, but it's the gospel of the first miracle of Jesus. And so I asked myself the question, what does this have to do with anything? And I began to look a little carefully at what we have in this first miracle in John. And I discovered something about miracles. The Bible actually uses three words for miracles. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the word most often used for miracles is dunamis, from which we get the word dynamite. It's about the power of God. And you can imagine when the power of God is such that the natural reality is transformed by this power, that we would understand that as a miracle. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, speak of miracles as power. And then in the Gospel of John, the second use is the word works. That is, the miracles of Jesus are described as the works that God gave him to do, revealing the Father to the world. But neither of those are what's used in our lesson for this morning. Our lesson for this morning ends with this different idea. And that is that what is happening is a sign, a symbol to reveal something deeper. And in the Gospel of John, all seven miracles of Jesus are said to be signs. And so we have this occasion of this wedding in a village, and they run out of wine. Now, weddings are huge village-wide events, and they usually go on for a week, if you can imagine. Any of you paid for your daughter's weddings? 3 hours is plenty. No. This is a week-long ordeal, and they have to have enough wine to get them through the entire week for the entire village, and if they run out, they are shamed. But that's not necessarily where the sign is. Our gospel concludes with this miraculous sign, but then we're told that standing by were six stone water jars used for the Jewish ceremonial washing. Each could hold 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus told the servants, fill the jars with water. Now, when you look at that image, you can see that these were not jars that they carried over to the well. They had to bring the water to these stone basins. And when you see that, you can begin to understand why there's a discrepancy. Is it 20 or 30 gallons? Well, close. Somewhere in there. Again, not the important part of the story. What's the important part of the story? What's the symbol? What's the sign? These were the jars used for ceremonial washing. What does that mean? It means that before the Jewish people could come to worship God, they had to be purified. They had to be cleansed. And now Jesus turns the water into wine. The same wine that at the Lord's Supper he's going to say, this is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many, for the purification of your soul, the forgiveness of your sins. There's a foretelling that what is going to cleanse you isn't going to be washing your hands. That doesn't mean don't wash your hands. But what is going to cleanse your soul, what is going to purify you so that you can stand before God is the blood of Jesus. And you don't stand up this morning, Abby or Joe, you don't stand up this morning making a commitment that somehow you're going to be able to do something. You stand up rather trusting in the power of God to do something in you. He will forgive your sins. He will strengthen you and make you his own by his power and goodness. And he will not stop until he has his way with you. Which means that we're in this journey of transformation throughout our entire lives. The second lesson for this morning contains within it one of my favorite verses. 1 Corinthians 12:7. Memorize, the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the common good. Otherwise reading, a spiritual gift is given to each of us so that we can help each other. Each of you is anointed by the Holy Spirit so that you can make a difference, so that you can contribute to the common good of God's people. You, like all the people of Israel, have been blessed to be a blessing. And so we are called to seek out that blessing so that we can use it to bless others. That's the journey of the servant life of God's people. There are, by the way, in case you're wondering, different kinds of spiritual gifts, but it is the same God who does the work in all of us so that we can help each other. We're not intended to be the same. Even as we're being transformed into the likeness of Jesus, we're not being transformed into one thing. Each one of us is uniquely gifted. Now, I hate to tell you this, but in case you haven't figured this out, God is not Santa Claus. And unlike Christmas, you don't necessarily get what you want. You don't get to decide what your gift will be. If you want to be taller, wear high heels. The stretching rack, I'm told, doesn't work, at least not for the long term. As a matter of fact, as we get older, most of us get shorter. So, what is this saying to us all? It's saying that the Spirit alone decides which gift each person gets. Our calling by God is to discover the gifts He's given us so that we can put them to work for the common good. And a part of the question to you confirmands today, and a part of the questions for the rest of us who are here is, will you? Will you seek to discover the gift that God has put in you? Will you surrender to the power of God at work in you for the sake of others? Will you surrender to the power of God to work through you to make a difference, to shine your light so that others can see and discover that they too are loved by God, that they too have a commitment by God that He is not going to stop until He has His way with their hearts and with their lives. Joe and Abby, you're in the midst of adolescence, which means that you're in the midst of sort of solidifying your identity. And much to your parents' chagrin, it means you're finding this independent streak, and they're, of course, you know, jerking you back. It's their job to put boundaries on you so that you can grow and be safe, and it's your job to bump up against those boundaries, to let them know when you're ready for some wider boundaries, so that you can discover who you are. I'm sorry, I don't buy in to this phrase, you can be anything you want to be. But I do buy into this, you can be anything God wants you to be. And as you discover His work in your life, I pray for each of us that we will be willing to allow God to use us, to allow God to make our light shine so that they can see our Father in heaven and give Him glory. Thanks be to God. Amen.